the first song played on this brand new radio station, Hits Radio Pride, from years and years. Olly Alexander was here to help me out. I mean, I don't know how you feel. I am on cloud nine.
I feel amazing. It's so I feel very honoured that I've been a part of this historic moment and touched, really. Yeah.
There was no one else like
I'll stop it.
That I wanted on this. Oh, come on. You know, take it. Come on, take it. And I mean, let's chat about it. Because I mean, music is something ingrained in, you know, our community. It's the thing we dance to. It's the thing we cry to. It's the thing we make. We're so creative in that. So why do you think this station is so important? Why, you know, it's an added voice in our community. But what is it about music and radio and stuff that can connect with people, do you think?
Gosh, well, I think there's loads of things about, you know, I think we're a community and more than ever, we need to find ways to commune with each other. And we have to make the best use of, we have to make use of networks to do that, you know, and a radio station, I think, is a network that connects people. And queer as queer people, you know, the connections between us is what really makes us who we are and kind of, I've always believed that, and if we can, you know, the more that we connect with each other, the more that we kind of find out about ourselves and each other. So that's why I think it's always cool, and I love radio. You know, I think it has a really queer history, but it's more important than ever to kind of like, and this is what you guys are doing, is like doing it right now and having, you know, because there aren't that many radio stations that do this, and I think the more that we can provide for people, you know, that's going to be the more the better. So.
Yeah, I always think, you know, I love a Friday night playlist. I love that kind of thing. But I also feel like for some people, you know, growing up in areas where it's not as, you know, being gay or being queer is not the norm. Maybe you're in a small village in the middle of nowhere. And I always think with radio, you can connect so much and you can always feel that someone else is out there with you. And that is, you know, personally, that's what I want. But like, what about you when you were growing up and stuff? Like, how was that? I don't know, like location for you. How was that community with you? Did you have that? Did you have to find it?
Well, I grew up in I grew up half in Blackpool and then half in like a rural town in the Forest of Dean. Mm. And also at a time when I myself like wasn't out, you know, I wasn't out as a teenager. And gay people, queer people didn't really exist to me. Like I didn't see them anywhere. I didn't see them, you know, it wasn't part of, you know, a curriculum in the school or, you know, we just had none of that. But one of my closest friends, and he didn't know it at the time, neither of us did, but he was queer too. And we lived like two streets away from each other. So we grew up together. And that was really like, you know, I had like a queer sibling then. And I made another, you know, another friend at school who turned out to be queer. But at the time we didn't really know, but we were still supporting each other, just not in the way that like, I think maybe, you know, times have changed or whatever, but like you said, like hearing something on the radio, when you can hear a voice, like that connects you so deeply to someone in a way that, you know, I think that's pretty special.
What was a track that you heard growing up that you were like, I need this in my life 24/7, maybe it kind of helped you out at all? Is there any kind of like memory of that?
Oh my gosh. I mean, my mum used to play, so I was like really obsessed with the music that my mum played. So she was really into the Whitney Houston album with It's Not Right, But It's Okay on it. and actually like, loads of Whitney Houston songs. Like I still listen to them now, like Heartbreak Hotel. Oh my gosh, I love that song so much. Your Love's My Love, obviously. So that stuff really makes me listen to my mum. When I listen to it now, it really makes me think of my mum, but it also makes me think of like, you know, being kind of a young gay boy, kind of like not really understanding why these like songs made me feel so empowered and kind of like I had this, you know, identity that I liked when I was, you know, singing along the words to them, but I didn't really understand why. But I think those are kind of my early anthems.
Oh, I love it. Good choices. Yeah. Good choices. And you took a moment out of your Glastonbury set to just kind of reflect on anything and, you know, growing up and being queer and, you know, and for that moment to, you know, be on that stage in front of, you know, hundreds of thousands of people there, but millions of people around the world. I mean, what was that like and what went into that decision to kind of take that moment and be like, you know what, I'm going to talk about this. This is important and this is what I want to say.
Well, I don't really remember that. Remember it, like, it's honestly such a blur. But I think, you know, I was, my thought process was like, well, this you know, playing Glastonbury, the Pyramid Stage, we might never ever play a show bigger. You know, that really is the biggest show we've ever done, really, and it's an important show for us because, you know, we love Glastonbury and everything, and it often falls around Pride. And I guess I just think I really believe in that, like, the power of a great, great pop concert, you know, people having fun, you're celebrating, and, you know, all that stuff is already there without you having to, you know, deliver a message. But I thought that there is a lot that needs to be said in the world right now, right? And I only really had a few minutes, but I wanted to encourage people to think about the word queer, what the history of queer is. Maybe that would encourage people to find out a little bit more about themselves, but above all, to just encourage people to, I don't know, if you can forge a bit of, like, if you can deliver a message to people and leave them with a little bit of understanding of something that they might not necessarily have had, because obviously a lot of our fans are queer and I don't need to tell them about this stuff, but lots of people who come to see us, especially at something like Glastonbury, that's a huge, huge, huge audience, and I wanted to leave them with something that that hopefully will take away with them and remember.
Do you ever feel like you said, you know, a lot of your fans are queer, a lot aren't as well. Do you feel like in the music industry, or maybe in yourself and your band, that you have that responsibility to say that? Do you feel like it kind of sometimes falls on you to do it? Do you feel that pressure?
I do. Yes.
Yeah.
I do sometimes, yeah, but it's a bit silly because obviously, you know, I'm just one gay person, and you know, and there are just so many different experiences and different queer voices that we need to listen to and that need to be uplifted and upheld. But I'm often in situations where, you know, people, you know, for instance, in the band, you know, I am the only gay person in the band, so obviously, like, I am going to speak up about that in a way that, you know, that's, and I like to do it, you know, yeah. I actually do like to do it, but it's sort of a bit strange because
that's another reason that we're doing this, because it is like about, you know, some people might go like, oh, this person, it was always the case, like growing up, it'd be like, oh, he's gay, or that person's, or she's a lesbian, and I kind of feel like it's like, no, there's such a, we call it a spectrum for a reason. There, you know, right. We all sit on it, and this is another reason we're doing this radio station, so we can start to reflect and spotlight these people who play a massive part in our lives. Like, they soundtrack our lives. You soundtrack our lives. And I think that's the thing about bringing that momentum and that spotlight on more than just one person, even though it is beautiful to have you here. Do you know what I mean? I think that's really important.
It is. I mean, I think more than ever, we're understanding how, like, infinitely, infinitely complex, like, our sexualities are, our identities are, and all of it's good, you know, like, every different facet, every different side to it that you can express, like, I want to hear that, I want to see that, and that's why I'm so excited about how many queer artists there are now, how many people, like, killing the game, Eminike, you know, like, and that's just really amazing to see.
Yeah, and you are, like, an act, is the right word, activist? I mean, like, I watched your documentary, like, Growing Up Gay, and you know, you are really open with it. And I think that is obviously admirable. And you've been very open about your mental health and things like that. I mean, did you struggle to open up, or was it kind of like just a natural thing as an artist, as a creative, you kind of, you know, you lay a lot of that in your music. And then does that just kind of extend into you talking about it?
Oh, thank you, Jordan, by the way, for being so nice to me. That's really nice. I wouldn't describe myself as an activist, no, just because I think, you know, well, actual activists, you know, spend a lot of their time and being activists and advocating for change. And I do some of that. I do some advocating for change, sure. Like, and I'm really passionate about it. But I think, you know, I'm mostly an artist. I'm like an entertainer and a performer. But it has always been super important to me, just because... to kind of like make the things that I believe in, and you know, advocating for a better world for LGBTQ people, for all people, you know, that's just part of my like kind of daily life as well. Like I just try and do things that will kind of hopefully lead to that, you know, lead in that direction. So I've put it in all of my work as well with years and years. I've tried to at every stage kind of think, well, am I like using my platform in the best way, or is there something more I could do that would kind of help here? So I'm always asking myself those questions. But it's also just like for my mental health and stuff, like part of the way I kind of like maintain good mental health is by kind of being open about what I'm going through. And that's just something I learned in therapy really over the years. So that's kind of, I applied that same thing to when interviewers start asking me questions, they'd be like, oh, and what's this song about? And I'd just be like, well, I was depressed and I was in love with a boy. So, and it kind of went from there.
I feel you. Therapy brothers, because it just, yeah. I think a lot of people kind of like think you hear the word therapy and you go, oh, but I mean, it's like you say, I mean, therapy for everyone is different. Therapy could be, my whole thing with lockdown and mental health and all that was take an album, put it on an iPod so I didn't have my phone, and go for a walk and listen to that album. And oh, that was so the nice. Way, yeah, that was the way that I kind of took myself away and reset. And I think, you know, it's so important to look after it. And I think having these open conversations, like you said, just inspires other people to even think about theirs. And I think that is so important.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Like, so not everybody, it's not the right choice for everybody to get therapy. And lots of people might not be able to, you know, either it costs money or it's hard to access through the NHS. But I can tell you now, like one of the really amazing benefits of like therapy is that you have this dedicated, let's say an hour a week, where you're just spending that hour and it's just to help you. It's just for you to focus on you and yourself. And like what you just said, you spent a bit of time just with your music on your iPod going for a walk. Like that's time that you dedicated for yourself. And that's so important. You know, it can just be stuff like that. And you know, it's good to hear you say that you know, I've been enjoying music in that way as well recently, for the first time in ages, just listening to albums and being like, whoa, this is so fun, you know? So
what are you listening to?
It can be lots of different stuff. I've been listening to a lot of 80s music.
Ooh.
Yeah, kind of trying to get a bit of 80s dance, 90s dance, you know, Pet Shop Boys, New Order, kind of, yeah, lots of that stuff, actually.
The legends. I need new music from you so I can put it on an iPod and, you know, have a walk. Like, that's my priority right now.
Well, I hope soon.
That face tells me everything I need to know. That is all I need. One final question, because you know we got a bit deep there, we got a bit heavy, and I think I want to bring it back to, you know, the reason we're doing this is celebration.
Sorry,
and
did I get too deep?
Hey, I pushed you there. Don't blame me. It's all me. You know, like prides across the world are being cancelled, and you know we are feeling a bit isolated. But I think sometimes it's always just good to go like, remember the good old days. I mean, like, you know, we were together last year at Manchester Pride. I got to introduce you, and we were just saying like that was a moment, but. For you, what has been like one moment or like the best thing about being part of this community? What is the thing that you will cherish more than anything?
Oh my gosh, that's such a hard question. I feel like there's so many things. You know what I am, when you just mentioned Manchester Pride, it made me think of how, like, I'm so lucky that I get to go to all these prides like around the world. So I've been to prides or different kind of, you know, like in America, we've done, even in places like, so we did a show in Russia. And, you know, it's very different for LGBTQ people in Russia. You know, their lives are very different to where they are here. But, like, I cannot tell you how amazing and, like, rainbow-filled our show was there. And I think for me, being able to meet queer people, you know, around the world and just see a tiny little bit of how their communities are and you know, I hear fans of the bands just talking to me about what they're up to and what kind of, you know, it's so, so inspiring. There's so many amazing queer people around the world doing things, making stuff happen. And that's really, it's so wonderful and inspiring to feel like, wow, I'm part of a community that is so brave and so courageous and continues to do so under, you know, in different parts of the world all the time. That's just so inspiring to me.
And you can have those conversations and it be like a natural thing. I think, you know, like you say, we connect on so many levels and music plays a massive part of that. But just being human and being in that moment is also just like the most important thing.
Totally, totally. And that's what I really, you know, I think obviously we're struggling now to it's different connecting online or whatever, but we can still do it. But that's what I miss so much about, you know, like being with people, because that's a special thing, you know. I miss that.
I miss it too. Don't worry, as soon as we're allowed to, I am coming to you and we're having the biggest hug ever.
Yeah, I can't wait.
Olly Alexander, it's been an honour, a privilege, a pleasure. Thank you so much for launching Hits Radio Pride. I'm forever in your debt.
Oh my God, no, thank you for having me. It's been a pleasure.